Welcome to tonight's edition of Las Películas Sábados Gigantes at the Cinemarijuana Theatre. Sorry if that sounds a little less than enthusiastic or underwhelming. We're running on a skeleton crew tonight here on night two of Comic-Con.
We're trying to not wake up the people who are not with us in person but in spirit as they're crashed out 8 feet away in our suites, in the Comic-Con suite.
Namely, regular contributors Condi and Dr. Matlis are out. Because it's late. It's 2 a.m.
Really?
Very late.
I still got to drive home.
Yeah.
I still got to get to my car.
It's 2 a.m. Here at Comic-Con on technically Saturday morning. But it's Friday night. It's day two for us, or the conclusion of day two. We're doing this late because it's been an incredibly busy fucking day. As every year at Comic-Con, there's... You basically have to, like, circle everything you want to do and then cut it into, like, half or, like, thirds.
Especially, too, on Friday and Saturday nights, since there's late-night programming, there's just so much to do.
Yeah.
There's no way you could ever come close to fitting it all into one evening.
Because then you also have to do things like eat and bathe and sleep.
And eating was what really took a big chunk out of this evening, and drinking booze, too.
But that was a lot of fun.
Well, and that was part of the experience.
We drank a fishbowl cocktail, which was a half gallon of various booze and mixers, which was pretty nice.
And it was glorious.
So before we tuck into the meat here, let's introduce ourselves, introduce the skeleton crew. Starting with me and going clockwise, I'm Ed.
I'm Comic John at Comic Con.
And I'm Zeb.
And okay, so day two, excuse me, there was a lot of kush to smoke.
And there will continue to be.
Yes, yeah, so we're about to vape on some mercury. Or
some mercurus.
Mercurus, as our beloved Dr. Steve Brule would call it, mercury OG, as it is a pretty bomb-ass indica, and it's time for bed, so it's bedtime bud here at the fucking Cinemarijuana Theater on location.
I still got to drive home.
Yeah.
I have like an hour drive home.
I know. I feel really bad for you,
Zeb. Maybe
30
minutes with no traffic at this time.
Yeah, you should make it pretty quick, quick.
And then back again in about, 4 hours.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's funny. This is something to bring up and talk about, I guess, for... And if anybody listening who's initiated, who knows Comic-Con, depending on if you're doing it right or not, you understand this. Or for people who don't know, it's something to prepare yourself for. But sleep isn't really something that goes with Comic-Con.
No.
Yeah,
never.
Sleep is not your friend at Comic-Con.
Now, well, it is in that when you can get it, it's wonderful.
True.
But the thing you have to resign yourself to is that you're going to be, by the time Sunday rolls around, you're like, you shouldn't drive on Sunday night. You know what I mean? Like, you're going to be hazardous because
should catch a ride.
There's too much to do. The shit goes, it starts too early. It goes too late, especially if you wait in any kind of lines for anything. If you're a Hall H person or a Funko vinyl pop person, sleep is just something that's not really happening here.
Because
the
party starts early and it goes late.
Case in point, that's why we are down.
We got two more days of this, too.
We're just getting warmed up.
Yeah, Condi and Dr. Matlis both out with fatigue. Because Condi's working the Toy Wars booth. Dr. Matlis is working that Comic-Con hustle with us.
And I can speak from personal experience that working a booth at a convention, especially one with the size and scope of Comic-Con, is incredibly tiring. And when it's over, you don't really want it. I mean, that's one of the reasons why I never wanted to work a booth at Comic-Con, because when your day is over, you don't want to do anything. You want to eat some dinner and go the fuck to sleep.
Yeah. I've often thought it might be neat to work the con and see it from that angle, but now I realize, like, I definitely don't. Like, I want to be exhausted from doing the shit, not from, like, slinging shit.
Yeah. I mean, it is fun. It is cool to see that side of it, but it's only for the novelty of seeing that side of it, but it's nowhere near as much fun or as being enjoyable as actually enjoying the con as an attendee.
So, One thing we should mention off the bat is the little celebrity counter
we
have. The
Confederate flag is on the screen behind you guys.
Oh, yes. We're watching. We got some droopy cartoons on.
The racist droopy cartoons.
They had a whole thing taking it down today, I guess, where they... And I guess people were all pissed because they gave it, like, color guard honors or some shit.
Oh, when they took it down?
When they decommissioned it or whatever.
So, like one last slap in the face.
I don't know. Whatever. The Cinemarijuana Theater is not here to discuss those things unless they're brought up by a
movies.
Film. We had a little celebrity encounter, right? As we left, we were at Brian's 24/7. Which is a nice little restaurant up here on 6th Avenue in San Diego.
French toast.
Yeah.
Oh, man, the chicken and waffles, country fried steak.
Everything's
huge
good.
Huge beers.
They're open. Yeah, they got a full bottle. Yeah, 32-ounce Stella's.
Just these ridiculous steins. It's like a one-man pitcher, practically.
Yeah, it was great. And relatively affordable, too. And that's where we got this fishbowl cocktail.
It's a relative term.
But we were on our way out, and who was outside hanging out of their...
Kevin Smith.
Their livery-plated vehicle, but yes, Kevin Smith, Mr. Comic-Con.
I was like, oh, that's Kevin Smith.
Yeah.
I believe I'd take a photo with
him. Was he? He was hollering about some shit to somebody. What was he talking about?
Well, it was a TMZ guy.
Okay.
TMZ's down here. They're collecting, like, shit for their website.
Okay.
So if they see somebody, like, from Hall H, they're going to go like, oh, what do you think about this?
Sure.
Just slinging stupid questions at them. So they were...
General paparazzo
They were just talking to him about Superman, Batman versus Superman, superhero movies. And you could tell Kevin Smith just wanted to get the hell out of there. It's like, I just got done doing whatever I did.
Yeah, I wonder where he... Is he staying at the Ramada there? Or is he... what was he doing there?
I have no idea. We just walked out, and there he was, like, near the entrance.
His panel was today. It went till 9, he probably did what we did. He probably went out and got some dinner, some drinks.
The bummer is that Kevin Smith is now a huge advocate of marijuana, and if we had a... I feel like we were right next to the car. Maybe if we had said, like, dude, Kevin, like, you want to smoke some California Kush, dude? Like, we got some good bomb-ass bud. He might have been like, where?
Yeah,
and we might have. I
so
now
skinny.
I
skinny.
In retrospect, I really feel like I blew up by not saying anything because I don't think anybody else had the balls.
There was really
push.
No way to get a word in edgewise because everybody was trying to get a photo of him, and TMZ dude was just being loud, obnoxious, and taking up everything.
I should have just busted in on the shot because that's something I want to talk about Comic-Con, right? Photo opportunities. All right. You're trained to, like, respect that shit, right?
No, fuck that.
But that's why I love that whole fucker right in the pussy thing. Because not because I think, like, that's such a pithy statement, but because it's trolling fucking live television where there's this kind of belief that you're supposed to abide and it's just you have to stay out of their way.
Yeah, like this unnecessary reverence for the media.
Right, right. Now, so, like... Just like with this Kevin Smith thing, I should have said, dude, this is my one chance. Dude, this is me and Kevin Smith right here. I just get in the way of this guy's shot. Fuck him. He's TMZ. If he wants me to move, motherfucker, pay me. You know, but I got someone to ask Kevin Smith right now. And I should have fucking jumped up and been like, hey, like, dude, you got to come smoke this OG Kush. You know what I mean? But instead, I'm like, no, I be my docile self. And... That brings me sort of to something that Jesus Christ.
Sorry.
Fucking A, Mickey Mouse, loud as fuck. Something that I want to get you guys to chime in on this at Comic-Con. Now, everybody knows it's a huge cosplaying thing.
Mm-hmm.
Cosplayers from around the country, around the world show up to put on their fucking Sunday best and strut their shit. Half of them want to start, you know, blog issues about guys taking pictures of their ass.
Well, their ass is on full
display. But I think it can be agreed all of them are wanting to show off. And sure. To be fair, a lot of them put a lot of work, a lot of creativity in these costumes. A lot of these costumes look kick ass. Okay. But here's my fucking thing. There's 125,000 motherfuckers plus at this thing, not counting vendors, the people working there, all that kind of shit. These assholes posing for photos, particularly in the dealer's room, when people are trying to move and you got lanes of traffic backing up so everybody can respect some dickhead's fucking desire to fucking snap a fucking picture of these people posing. Like, fuck you. Now, I obviously want to get you guys' thoughts on this, but for me, it's like, fuck you. There are so many more people trying to move through, get through here. Like, there should be some photo opportunity area. There should be some place for this where, like, it's okay and you don't have motherfucking traffic going through. What goes on?
We're being serenaded.
And where's that coming
from? A sax outside. You guys have the window open.
We had that the other night.
Oh, there's a sexy sax man outside.
Yeah, he was here the other night. I don't know. It's a fucking
sexy sax solo.
It's the guy. It's Andrew Ridgely.
Yeah, well, I agree with you, Ed. But, and I don't respect the photo area.
So you'll just walk cut right in front.
I'll just
like
fucking cut right in front.
Beautiful, beautiful. Me
too.
Because
I got places to go, people to see, urinal cakes to urinate on.
That's right. To dissolve.
Well, that's why I keep, like, I just tell people, hey, can I take a quick photo of you? Thank you. One and done. I'm not like, all right, step back. Okay, pose and do this. Like a lot of people are.
Yeah, and like are the people who want their kids to get in there for the photo.
Oh, fuck the kids.
So
why
you
are
got some
kids at
toddler
Comic-Con?
Who's got to kind of go over and try to stand there for the picture and stuff. So, like, don't put your kids in the photo. Like, just, yeah, say if you want a photo of somebody, take a quick one. But like when you're trying to move to the dealer's room, especially in the major walkways, and then all of a sudden it's at a dead stop. Because a bunch of people are crowding around to take a photo. And then if the person starts posing, then more people stop to take photos. And then the whole thing fucking clogs up.
And it's not like they're taking just one.
No.
They're taking a fucking bunch.
Yeah. And then,
they're posing, which pisses me off.
Yep. And they have to have room, so they're blocking a whole fucking walkway. And people are like, you know, bloating the aisles, like just stuffing up in the fucking aisles.
There should really be, like, yeah, there should be a section for it where people can go, and you've got, like, a Comic-Con backdrop.
But, I mean, could you regulate that, though?
No. It would just be a spot.
I mean, because really, it is a pain in the ass, but most of those photo opportunities are, like, really realistically short enough that it would be difficult to crack down on them.
It's just something you got to deal with. It's just, it's just like the idea, like if you're listening to this and you're thinking of coming to con and you never come to con, you do come to con. I mean, think about this as like con etiquette. Like, just like hey, like shower, you know, use deodorant and like mouthwash.
Please, people.
Don't crop dust. Yeah, don't have a backpack that's
you
like larger than like a, you know, three, like, you know, dwarves.
Don't even get me started.
Sometimes crop dusting is
Yeah, I do it in front of kids and strollers.
Oh, my God.
Don't. No. Please
finish this, my sentence before we move on.
Yeah.
And don't, you know, and just be respectful. If you're going to have somebody take a photo, just take a fucking quick one. Preferably just of the person. Don't get other people in there. Don't get your kids have to get in there. Your boyfriend, your girlfriend. Just take the shot and move on. And try to find a way to do it. And like if you're the person posing for the photo, try to step back to the side. There's naturally occurring obstacles like trash cans and those big cement columns you can use where people can't walk anyway, so you can kind of step to the side.
Or the corners by the doors to the exhibit hall.
Or like a lot of the big booths that the corporate booths are taking over more and more of the dealer's floor will have sides with nothing on them. You just got a wall.
Yeah.
And that's a great place to step to the side to take photos. So just be respectful of people trying to walk and just be, you know, intelligent and just try not to be an obstacle.
Which is the perfect segue to the next thing that I wanted to bring up that actually, Zeb, you already touched on that is an extreme source of frustration for me. And I try not to be too high strung about this event. Like, I understand there's a lot of people here. And everybody's got something they're trying to do, and it, to them, it's just as important as whatever it is I'm trying to do is to me, right? But one of the things that just shits me right the fuck up is strollers in the dealer's room.
Does not belong.
Like, my thing is like, okay, you had kids, fine. Okay, you have to bring your kids to Comic-Con, and they're not autonomous enough to sort of be individuals.
Well, individually mobile. They can't
walk. Right,
on their own.
Okay, that's like, but to be like, well, I want to go to Comic-Con, and I made the mistake of having children that I can't carry, and that can't move on their own, I've got to bring a stroller. I've got to bring a great big fucking shopping cart full of kid into this overcrowded space where there's not enough room for motherfucking people to walk around as it is. To me, strollers should be outlawed at Comic-Con. Like, if you can't handle your kid without a stroller, like, don't fucking come.
People,
but why should we all pay because you fucking had kids?
People have called for the banning of strollers at Comic-Con. I don't think it's anything they'll ever be able to do because it seems like everybody, there's such a strong desire to kid-proof this world.
Bullshit, get a fucking papoose.
Well, no, I agree, but it would, I think that, I mean, okay, obviously the people who are disabled who need wheelchairs and carts and stuff, I mean, you know,
dude, that's different, right?
But like, because I mean, honestly, if a kid is too small to walk, what is he going to get out of Comic-Con?
Like, I'm sure somebody with a kid would tell you that a stroller is a necessity, but to somebody from the outside, a stroller is looking like a motherfucking luxury.
Well, and you're not there for your kids. If you're at Comic-Con, your kids that small, you're
there
for yourself.
If they're that young, that's it. If they're young enough to be in the stroller, you ain't there for them.
I hate strollers just because every time I saw a stroller on the con floor, it was empty of a child, and it was filled with boxes and purses and stuff. And where was the kid? The mom was holding it.
So they're basically using them as shopping carts. They're basically, which you're not, I mean, you couldn't bring in a cart if you wanted to. So they're finding a way around that rule.
Yes. And it just, like I said, it shits me right up. Just so annoying. And sort of, we saw a woman today. I've never seen this in my life. She had this stroller for three kids. Oh, shit.
Oh no.
For fuck's sake.
Well, you're the one who put it set it up like that. That's not my fucking fault.
Are you really trying to suggest that what just happened is your fault?
No. What I'm saying is you're like, oh, it's going to fall off the end. Yeah, because all the cables are pulling on it.
What do you want me to do with them? You want me to go wireless?
I don't know, but I'm just saying that it is not stably placed.
I need these cables. There's nothing I can do about that. Now, where I need to...
Is it still recording?
Actually, yes. Surprisingly, okay. I'll have to remember to edit this.
Yeah, just cut that out. Just like Dana Carvey says, like, like it's gone.
So anyways, strollers.
Hang on. I can't hear.
Ed can't hear.
I thought
fuck
something
Ed.
Unplugged. I swear I saw
fuck
some cable
Ed.
Come out.
Fuck you, Ed.
Okay, there we go.
Hey.
Look, I've been drinking, all right?
No, well, I always think that if a kid can't walk on its own and it needs a stroller, it doesn't belong at Comic-Con.
Right. There's nothing for
it's
nothing
not,
for
it's,
a
the
kid
kids aren't getting
there.
Anything out of that shit other than just being wherever mom and dad drag it to. This woman today had a stroller with three kids in it, and it wasn't like three kids wide like it makes a difference. This was like Flume Ride. This was like Splash Mountain. It was like three strollers glued together in a line. To make this really long, really annoying stroller full of her fucking kids.
Like when you see somebody pushing like a rack of shopping carts at Target. Like it was basically the stroller version of that.
And I wanted to take that shopping cart. I wanted to take that stroller and just shove it right up her ass. I'm like, you bitch. Like, fuck you and your fucking kids. I'm sure this is sounding incredibly callous to people.
But
that's just how I feel. You know what I mean? Like there's a reason I don't have kids. And like, okay, that's cute that you want the world to be sensitive to the fact that to your plight, the fact that you were unfortunate enough to have them. But like, I don't there's a reason in my life I don't have them, and so I don't like having to fucking pay the price for yours.
I am concerned that we've done two of these in the first half.
Or it was bitching.
Both of them just us bitching nonstop. Because,
okay,
about,
all
like,
right.
Annoyances.
Okay, oh, okay. God. So let's. Which is funny because I know one more thing I want to gripe about. But let's talk about something positive. What happened today positive that we could talk about?
All right. Well, I'm just going to run through what we did today really quick.
Okay.
And then we can discuss in the details. So to start off with,
yes.
Once again, Ed Matt got in the Funko line, which we'll talk about briefly.
Four of us tried, two of us made it.
Yeah, Condi and I got shut out. Me, like four people from the front, which is really annoying to be that close to being in. But that did free up some time for me to check out some anime and hit the dealer's room, so it wasn't a complete loss. But then we all got back together just in time to head upstairs. We caught the end of the graphics publishing panel.
With the bone guy, Jeff, what's his face?
Yeah, Jeff Loeb?
No.
No, it's that's somebody else. Smith. Jeff Smith.
Yes.
Jeff Smith, who does Bone. Yeah, he was there because...
And Fred Tatasciore, the voice actor, was there.
Oh, yeah, I mean, he must write something, too, because I think they were all authors.
Second to the end, yeah, he missed.
So it's a company, a publishing company that works in conjunction with Scholastic Books to provide graphic novels for kids in schools, so that was really interesting. Then there was a really great Disney Animators, The Power of 2D panel, which had some classic Disney animators, both past and present. And they were talking
including
about...
Including Willie Ito, who we've seen a bunch.
Who was definitely a comic con and convention in general, a perennial favorite.
Staple.
Yeah, and so they talked about 2D animation, which is something that's rapidly disappearing in the world we're in. And then after that was one of our top highlights so far of this convention, and that was the Lost in Space 50th anniversary panel.
Yeah, that was the big thing for me all weekend.
Yeah, which is going to be a huge thing, which we'll talk about that. Then we hit the dealer's room for a little bit more, and then we went back for the Klingon Lifestyles panel, which, if you've never seen, is quite a thing to see.
I was so confused. It was
quite
my first
a spectacle. And then finally, the last thing was Spike and Mike's sick and twisted animation, The Gauntlet, where they just run through just a bunch of...
Another annual staple.
Yeah, another annual favorite of ours, where they just run through a bunch of animations. Some really good, some not so good, and you as the audience get to judge it. And that does, on some level, help determine what makes it into the Spike and Mike show that tours then for the following year. So, you know, things that we like or dislike will may or may not get picked.
Our opinion has weight.
It does have weight, yes.
Yes.
So that was, yeah, and then that was our day at Comic-Con today, so...
What about you, Zeb? What did your day?
Yeah, what was your?
Because you're considerably more, shall we say, nomadic.
Mm-hmm.
A con going.
I hate hanging out with people. I'll be honest. I hate hanging out with people at the con because they cramp my style and they hold me back.
Yeah. No, I know exactly how that feels like. Because when you really do it right, you know what you want to do,
and I know what I want to do. And you know, when I'm by myself, I'm like, yeah.
You can do it.
I could do it, but I met up with a group of friends today, quote-unquote friends, and one was a cosplaying as Bombshell Harley Quinn, her boyfriend was the Riddler, and then her friend was the Scarecrow. And the first thing I realized, and then they had like some weird friend. I don't know if he was supposed to be Mad Max or not,
He was very
but
Mad
he
Max
had
lying.
He had like this huge backpack on, like, oh, obviously... Oh, you're of the nomadic lifestyle as well,
right?
And he was being loud and obnoxious, and I noticed, I'm like, hey, there's four of you, and I'm counting two badges.
How'd they all get in?
Yeah, so I'm like, hey, when the hammer comes down, I don't want to be here.
Well, yeah.
Plus, homeboy looking like Mad Max was too loud and like obnoxious and. It was like, hey, you know those crack addicts that hang out outside the con going, hey, man, what's this going on down here?
Yeah. He
was kind of like that, but very loud.
Oh, God.
And not so crack addict-y. So I just was like, you know, I'm getting the fuck out of here.
I think I've got to move on to greener pastures.
Yeah, and I did. And boom, bumped into the queen of cosplay herself, Jessica Negri, and her double D's.
Jesus. Did you actually bump into the double D's?
Yes.
It was funny. Nice. The photo.
I was like, oh, sorry. Can I have a photo?
Yeah, I'm not really sorry, though. The photo you posted on Facebook has you in between her and another.
I don't know who the fuck that other girl was.
You
she
know
was
what?
Just in the shot.
But she was smoking
on my Instagram, I cropped her out.
both of them, and I don't know if this was an affectation of the costume or whatever, but both of them seem to have enormous breasts. And when I first became aware of the picture, Dr. Matlis showed it to me. And I was like, oh, because I've heard that name before, Jessa Negri, right? N-I-G-R-I, Nigri, yeah. Isn't that it? Right?
Yes.
Nigiri?
Is that Nigri. It?
Nigri, yeah. I was like, oh, which two are her? Because there's just so much tits in the picture.
Yeah, so, and then what else happened? Oh, I bumped into some other people, too, and took some photos with them, and... yeah, I had a better time by myself, and that's just been the theme at this year's con. It's just like every time I'm by myself, I have better luck.
Right.
I'm able to see stuff, meet different people. People were able to approach me more.
Yeah. You had, speaking of meeting people, you had another celebrity sighting yesterday, right?
Yes.
Did you want to elaborate on that a little bit since you weren't here yesterday to talk?
He had more than one.
I had multiple.
He just had one really good one that was really hot.
One A-lister.
And then, and then other dudes.
Then a complete sausage fest.
Yeah, and well, I have my lucky Comic-Con bag that I bring to every Comic-Con, and it's filled with pin bags and buttons that I've collected over the years, and I just tacked them on there. Students have given me buttons, or people give me buttons, and I just tack it on there. And I bring with me at every Comic-Con.
So you're ready to trade at any time?
No, I'm not trading. I only accept.
What?
This ain't Disneyland.
Yeah, fuck Disney.
Jeez, I thought we lived in a Disney world.
No, we don't.
You think?
We live in the real world, which is where I live in. And so I'm just walking down the, you know, exhibit floor, just looking around, and then someone goes, "Hey, I like your bag. You got a lot of pins on there. That's awesome. I like that pin." And I'm like, "Oh, yeah, I've just been collecting for several years." And then I look up. I didn't look at who was talking to me. I just looked at the bag.
Right.
And I'm like, "Oh, yeah, you know, oh, you like that one?" And then I looked up, and it was friggin' Roller Girl herself, Heather Graham.
Nice. Jeez. All right.
Looking banging, smoking hot.
Smoking hot. Chops, acting chops, and smoking
and
hot.
And I'm like, "Oh, thanks. Can I take, like, a selfie with you?" And we're walking, and she goes, "Yeah, just make it real quick." And I was like, "Chicka, chicka, 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 chicka." All right, thanks. And I just made a hard left. Let her go on to where she wanted.
You don't want to overstay that welcome.
Yeah.
No,
you
don't
wanna,
I don't. I know
you don't
want
to make
it
creepy. Yeah, you know, I know how that feels. You don't want to leave a bad, be the one that leaves a bad taste in their mouth either. You know,
so
I mean? You
want to
be
like,
the one that go like, "Yeah, all right." You know, some people were pretty cool.
So I was very happy person for the rest of the day, and then walked around some more, and then bumped into Doug Jones.
Yes.
For you kids that don't know who Doug Jones is,
from
he
Pan's
played
Labyrinth.
Pan's Labyrinth, Abe Sapien in Hellboy, Hellboy 2, and he was in some other movies. I just can't think
of
it because I'm tired.
He's been in a couple of those. Yeah, I don't want to pull up IMDb, but he's definitely been around.
Yeah. And dude, motherfucker's tall.
Really?
Yeah, and I'm like, "Okay, can I trouble you for a selfie?" And he's like, "Oh, you could trouble me at all."
He's like, "I'm going to have to kneel down."
And so, like, we get to the shot, and then I feel something on my head, and he's tussling my hair and stroking it. And I'm like, I don't know what's going on here.
Else.
But it's very sensual.
Very
what
arousing.
What a nice guy. What a friendly celebrity.
And then on preview night, actually, I was just walking around the floor, and I was near the Warcraft, the film Warcraft that's coming out. They had a booth there, Legendary. And I notice Duncan Jones, the director of Moon, Source Code, and the upcoming Warcraft. And I'm like, "Oh, hey, can I take a photo with
you?" Well known in artsier circles, mainstream U.S. success has sort of eluded him at the moment.
Until Warcraft comes out.
Yeah,
is that like World of Warcraft?
You know, that depends on how they market it and how much quality they actually let happen. Because I got to imagine the online fan base for that is going to be so just ridiculous.
So I just said, "Hey, can I take a photo with you?" "Oh, yeah, sure." And took a photo with him. "Oh, so you enjoying the con?" And we just talked until they closed the exhibit hall floor.
Oh, that's cool.
So it was really cool. We talked the IT crowd and Moon and the upcoming film.
So those are the great moments of Comic-Con when, like, you can find that kind of experience.
Yeah, no.
But in a not cliched or traditional or disappointing way, when you actually find yourself, like, genuinely in that situation where you're, like, in the elevator with somebody or you're occupying space with somebody and you know, small talk is required. You know what I mean? You just like, it's almost like an automatic thing. I don't know. All right. Well, yeah. What should we?
Talk about the Klingon lifestyles panel. We should talk about Lost in Space.
Okay.
Let's talk about that.
That was great. I mean, they had almost the entire surviving cast.
Yeah. Marta Kristen, Mark Goddard, Angela Cartwright, and Bill Mumy. We're all there. June Lockhart was not. She's still with us, but I have to imagine at her sort of advanced age. You know what I mean?
She just probably wasn't able to travel down for this.
Yeah. But it was, I mean, are you a fan of the show, Lost in Space at all?
I remember when June Lockhart used to come down here for Comic-Con.
Yeah?
She was a bit of a bitch.
Really?
Yeah.
Because she always seemed to me to be someone who had like a really sharp sense of humor.
No, well, it was hard because like people were approaching her and she was like charging for everything. And,
really?
Like photograph, she was charging for. Autograph, she was charging for. No small talk about Lost in Space or anything like that.
Really? Wow.
It was my turn and I'm like just observing her and I went up and I'm like, you know, I loved you in Petticoat Junction, you know, and it's a shame about Meredith McRae. She just breaks down and just starts talking about Meredith McRae, who played one of the Joe sisters.
Right.
I think after Gunilla Hutton left, she took over either Bobby Joe, Billy Joe, or Betty Joe. One of the Joes. Right. And she just started talking about, you know, Meredith McRae. I think that was her name that died. She, like, died 2 weeks before Comic-Con at that time. And I'm like, all right, cool. Can I get a photo? Oh, yeah. Took a photo of her. And then she went back to being a nicey bitch.
Really? Wow.
At least you saw more of a personal side of her for a moment.
Yeah, it's really cool. Just
well, I felt we saw very personal sides of everybody we saw on the panel today, and they were all pretty cool.
Yeah. Yeah,
especially Bill Mumy.
It was like, obviously, I mean, instead of promote something, because the Blu-ray set is dropping in September. The complete collection on Blu-ray from Fox.
On the very day of the 50th anniversary of the show.
Yeah, so if you're a fan, what better way to do it than you pre-order that shit from Amazon, and it shows up that day, and you just watch the pilot.
And you can buy it in advance here at the con, too. It's $99, and they give you a free T-shirt if you do it.
They don't,
it's not out yet, so you don't actually walk away with
it's a pre-order, but still.
I want to say, in addition to other stuff that was great about the panel, they, of course, showed a sizzle reel of some of the, the stuff, the restored stuff for the Blu-ray, and it looks beautiful.
Yeah, it looks gorgeous. They remastered it.
We have the whole series on DVD, and, I mean, we love it, but it looks like shit. You can see the square pixel edges of curved, you know what I mean?
Especially now when we have it blown up on a big
HD TV.
Uh-huh. I mean, some stuff like up converts and looks really clear still, but you can tell the stuff.
Up converts and shows you all the flaws more.
Right. I mean, you can tell the stuff that they really went in and meticulously remastered even on DVD, and you can tell the stuff that they probably just went from a VHS transfer and just basically
transferred over onto a
disc.
Not wasting any time or manpower.
Right. Because those are the ones that do not hold up on a Blu-ray, a player, and an HDTV. So, yeah, so it's great that that's out. But it was great to have them there because, yeah, they're there to sell something. But I think it was a little bit of a reunion for them. And I'm sure they loved
getting together. They've had a bunch periodically. But because from what I understand, being a fan of the show, that set, as I remarked to my comrades during the panel or right before it, it wasn't like Alf.
Mm-hmm.
The set wasn't, like, miserable and dangerous.
Was any set like Alf but Alf?
And people were, like, hating it. Every interview I've read or seen leads me to believe that these guys had the best time together. It was a fun show and a fun time.
And they became like a family, like they were on the show, like off the show, like a makeshift, like a home away from home, a family away from your family when they were working together.
So it was sad when the show ended, even though, you know, they all went on to do other bigger, better stuff. But still, I think, and there's some interviews with Bill Mumy for the Academy of Television Arts and Sciences at UCLA or something with like archival interviews. And there's ones with Gene Roddenberry, or not Gene Roddenberry,
Irwin Allen.
Yes, yeah. Or no, sorry, Bill Mooney.
Oh, okay, right.
Bill Mooney talking about it and just being, you know, really candid about not just the production of the show, but what came afterwards and stuff. And it was just total harmony on that set. They all loved each other. So when they get together now, like, I have to imagine they love it. Because it's like a chance to, it's like, oh, hey, like, I'm going to, you know, Lost in Space crew's getting together again. Yeah, like, hey, cool.
It's great. I mean, if you had these people from the past that you liked, I mean, you're basically getting paid, you know, to take a little vacation and hang out with your friends from the past. So,
And Marta Kristen really looks beautiful still. And she's sharp as a fucking tack. I mean, you know what I mean? Like, you can tell Marta Kristen has a really strong sense of humor, and it really comes through. Just when she talks about stuff, you know what I mean? Like, she seems like a very hip woman.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Which, from stories told from back in the day, makes sense when Bill Mooney talked about how much she exposed him to music and to, you know,
what was good.
What was good. What was, like, really good music at the time, especially in the 60s, obviously, some really good music. And at a time when being hip, you know, really meant something.
Right. And Mark Goddard, Major Don West, of course, very unique sense of humor, was pretty hilarious, was on point the whole time.
He was funny. He reminded me of, like everybody's, like, funny uncle.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like, if you got, like, a family get together, there's always, like, that one funny uncle who's the one who cracks jokes. Yeah,
that would be Mark Goddard.
That would be Mark Goddard. Yeah.
Angela Cartwright, Penny, what can I say? One of the most beautiful women ever on television. I mean, the third season of Lost in Space. I mean, she's pretty much the textbook definition of beauty. and also, she's done a lot of great work. This is also the 50th anniversary of The Sound of Music, which she was in. So it was wonderful to see her and kind of hear some of her reflections and recollections and stuff like that. And it was just the only thing I would have liked is if they had given us time to ask questions, because obviously I got a million for Bill Mooney, especially a million for everybody, but Bill Mooney, especially being a Barnes and Barnes fan, you know, I would have loved to have, you know, turned that panel on its ear and got him talking about, you know, Barnes and Barnes up there. I think that would have been so bitching. Or Bless the Beast and Children.
Well, that, yeah. And especially,
which he actually mentioned, which was great.
He did, and it did, it did garner applause.
A little bit from those of us that obviously know the film
it's
well.
It's a little bit of an obscure film.
Stanley Kramer film from 1971, I believe.
But I think if you've seen it, you'll never forget it.
Oh, it's once you've seen it. No, the images are... are just, yeah, no, you'll remember it forever.
I almost wish they had given them an hour and a half, because you think about it, it's such a momentous occasion getting these people together.
Yeah.
And
but they were really just there to plug. No,
that's true. But,
paid.
I mean, man, like, if you think about this as being, like, a big deal, like the 50th anniversary panel, like, and they had an extra 20, 30 minutes just to open up to questions, if nothing else.
Yeah, that's a Q&A.
It would have been cool. I mean, they could have shown a couple more clips from off of the Blu-ray or something. I think they
even if I had to ask Lost in Space only questions, I'm sure I could have figured it out.
You know, you could have come up with something.
Open it up to us, guys.
Yeah, but yeah, so that was definitely... that's one of the things that, like, in years hence, when you talk about this Comic-Con, like, oh, like, remember that year we saw The Lost in Space?
Right, yeah.
You know, the 50th
It was a big deal.
Thing?
Well, especially because, like, for me, like, getting into the show in my late teens, in reruns, like, discovering it and just absolutely falling in love with it, I had yet to have had this kind of opportunity, this kind of face-to-face sort of communion with these people with whom I have... for whom I have such respect and admiration and involvement with, even though they don't know me, but, you know, I feel like I know them.
Yeah, but
you really
know. Well, and when it is such a big deal, certain shows, it, you know, hitting the right point in your life, you know, and obviously we didn't watch it when it was on originally, but watching it in reruns, we caught it a good time, and, like, it really...
It just hit at the right time,
And it's like, and something strike a chord with you, and obviously, you know, we became instant fans of it. Yeah. To the point where, like, even years later, it's like, it's great. Like, I was thinking they were talking about some of the bonus features, and they were talking about there's some behind-the-scenes footage, some test footage that's never been released.
Right.
And I was thinking, we bought like a bootleg VHS
of the unaired pilot.
Of the unaired pilot and the bloopers. Cartoon. Yeah, the crazy Hanna-Barbera cartoon.
Yeah.
And just a bunch of that behind the scenes stuff. So yeah. It's like, well, I mean, because we're such like Lost in Space, you know, marks, we've already seen some of that stuff. So, you know, we're already ahead of the curve with that.
Yeah, it was nice. Like I said, I would have liked to have talked to Bill Mumy, but whatever. It was wonderful to see them all, because I'm a huge fan of that show. I even thanked them all at my graduation from high school, which I would have told them about, perhaps erroneously.
That would have been cool.
Whatever. I felt that strongly at the time that they needed acknowledgement during that most important of speeches.
September, was it 15th, 16th, something like that?
Yeah. We can find out.
Yeah, sure. But, you know, hey, if you listen to this and you're a Lost in Space fan, September something, 2015, that Blu-ray set drops, and it looks like it should be definitely worth picking
up. Yeah, I mean, just for the, it's worth it just for the transfers alone, because, like I said, I'm not trying to put anybody down by saying the ones that we have now look like shit, but, you know, comparatively, look like shit. And when you,
they were good.
I'm trying not to sound like that guy that was trying to sell you that VHS of Song of the South,
right?
Like when you see that shit just like light up on that digital Blu-ray, you're just gonna be like, oh my goodness.
Yeah, I mean, hey, they serve the purpose of the time, but they've definitely been outpaced by technology.
So
I'm looking forward to picking up the Blu-rays. And you'll be able to hear us actually watching the entire series.
Yeah, which is something we're doing as well.
Yeah,
putting together piece by piece.
Right, with our buddy Zombie Chris. When he eventually does get resurrected, he's still
as
not a, actually
a zombie.
Back
a zombie.
To life. When he is, we'll be doing a sort of a commentary, a fan commentary on the entire series.
Yeah, episode by episode.
Starting on DVD already, but then continue on Blu-ray once it comes out. So make sure to look for that.
Yeah.
Now I think we've got to talk about the Klingon Lifestyles panel at least a little bit.
I've been talking about that. So for anybody that doesn't know, I don't know if what kind of local organization it is that puts it on, but it's a very sort of, I hate to use the term grassroots, but it's a very sort of non-corporate Comic-Con panel where you have local Star Trek fans get together in costumes to put together A play,
basically,
or a show,
a performance,
musical review,
which they actually had a video intro, which I've never seen them do before,
with Jim Henson's voice.
Yeah, so they're getting a little more high tech now. So they had a little prologue they showed, and
a little sizzle reel.
And I mean, I assume it's some kind of a Klingon, you know, like almost like a Klingon 501st.
I wonder if they have a booth on the mezzanine.
Maybe they do, because I mean they incorporate other races into the group, but it is called the Klingon Lifestyles Panel, and they do mostly Klingons in the group, and they play the same characters every year. I think they said this like what they're 22nd. They've been doing it for almost as long as we've been going.
I believe that's what they said.
Yeah. So, and they play the same character. So there's technically sort of like this story arc that's
right.
been going through. But each one just sort of tells its own individual story.
Yeah.
And obviously it's a little bit tongue in cheek. They don't take themselves too seriously. There's some humor to it. I don't know if it's true or not. I actually overheard some people talking in another panel saying that like. Basically, if you show up in a Star Trek costume, you can be added to the production.
Which I almost kind of believe based on shit that I've seen in past years.
Yeah, well, and especially, too, for background characters. I mean, there's always a couple Klingons who don't have lines.
Yeah.
Or there'll be some Starfleet officers who just stand there holding a phaser. So I can see it's like, if you show up there and, hey, you're dressed in costume.
Right.
They'll find a place to stick in because it is a communal thing, which, I mean, so much. And it's funny, too. I feel like in some ways Star Trek is the purest Comic-Con thing because
it is in a lot of fandom conventions, fan conventions,
cosplay.
Really
this
fanfic,
this cult love of like Lost, like and past TV shows, this not letting things go, all of that, really started with Star Trek.
Okay. All right. Well, hey, we're gonna say goodbye to Zeb.
Yeah,
right
I gotta.
Now,
really I gotta oh, take off. Okay. I just hey, looked at the time.
Kind of the latest. Oh yeah, it's yeah. latest.
And I got like half an hour drive, hour to half an hour drive. I gotta go to my car first.
Okay.
I don't know if the shuttles are working. I've got to Uber this.
Shuttles are 24.
Yeah, okay. They're 27.
So.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you right. can get there is one that picks up in front of the hotel, right?
Yeah. There's a shuttle stop out of the corner. I don't know how long you gotta wait for it.
Yeah. Okay.
So, I might just take an Uber. I gotta get out of here.
All right. Well.
Thanks
yeah,
for hanging out.
No problem.
Thanks
yeah,
for
no shit.
Team
thanks
player.
For participating.
So if you hear the noise in the background, folks, that's me.
Yeah. So yeah, just hit up
is there
tomorrow.
A bathroom?
Yeah, right around the corner. Okay. Just hit up tomorrow, man. When you're here, we'll coordinate on this. Keep in touch. Okay, sorry, John. What were you saying?
Just how influential Star Trek has been on yeah. all of this. Like if you trace this mighty oak of Comic-Con and of this really. This fandom, this nerd, you know,
this obsessive
culture that we're really and I mean, yeah. I've actually one of the panels somewhere at Comic-Con refers to it as the pop culture bubble, which I would believe because at some point you think it's going to have to burst.
Oh,
but,
it's coming.
But yeah, but we're it's like coming. We are living in this pop culture time, and really you can almost trace all the entire thing back to Star Trek. So anytime there's anything Star Trek based at Comic-Con, I love to do it. It's a lot of fun, and there's a lot yeah. of good positive energy amongst Star Trek fans. It seems.
Yeah. It's we've done a little Star Trek celebrating.
Oh yeah, well we always yeah, do. We are. I mean, going nice. Back to our childhoods, fucking Star Trek fans.
I mean, Comic-Con was my first convention, but we've been going to Star Trek conventions as soon as they were in town.
Yeah, the
they
creation really conventions,
and those things have changed tremendously too from what they used to
well,
be.
Well, it didn't used to be about autographs, which is now the only thing
well,
that matters.
Yeah, well,
it's like it's,
cost, you can't.
And I hate
you can't go to the Grand Slam show like in Las Vegas for under like I swear to God, $800-900
well,
between the passes for the fucking con, all the autograph ops, and all like the celebrity breakfasts and luncheons and all that crap.
Well, I feel bad like so, like getting yeah. back on a tear about complaining, but it's like. In some ways, that what's convention dumb is becoming is it's like it's two things: it's exclusive merchandise,
yeah.
and it's autographs, which are just basically both excuses to part nerds from their money and as much
right.
money
even
as possible.
Totally willing, right.
And it's really kind of just sucking in some ways. And don't get me wrong, there's still plenty of love and passion at Comic-Con,
right?
But
oh, yeah.
it's like the companies out there are definitely trying to. Get their pound of flesh
yeah.
and making sure that they will just wring every red cent out of you that they can get.
Yeah. So, yeah, you know, it's a really, it's an interesting beast.
Yeah, it is. It's a double-edged sword. This current thing, it's really great. I mean, it's really great, this age we're living in. But
you know, it's funny, because now, like, I want to bitch about something about the Funko line, too, but I don't know, I feel like we're almost out of time.
Yeah, no, and well, we covered so much about that yesterday.
Yeah, but I would like to bring this up to more people to see if there's like any contrasting viewpoint.
Was it about how people are farting all the time?
Yeah, I'm wanting to know if there's anybody that doesn't like that, because I just love sniffing and huffing the farts of everybody in that line.
They're all packed in close proximity.
Which is great. It really packs the farts into my nose.
Yeah, that's really what you want.
Yeah,
by the way, were you actually being serious? That's what you really wanted to talk about?
No. Okay.
But that is a factor.
The farting was a thing. There was a lot of farting, and that's annoying. When you're stuck and you can't move and there's that much farting.
We were in a panel yesterday where there was one dude sitting in front of us. And every, maybe 30, 45 seconds, he
peace
just...
Peace, Seb. We'll see you tomorrow.
He just let one off, and it's just hitting you in the face.
Oh,
and it's
geez.
like you can't go anywhere, and...
Yeah, and, you know, again, and like, you're afraid everybody's thinking it's you.
That's a big thing, too. Like, I don't want people to be blaming me for it. Once again, this comes back to con etiquette, people. Like, just try to fart in bathrooms or outside. Don't crop dust. Don't fart when you're sitting right or standing in groups or big crowds. Just, man, because
but,
that is.
But
yeah.
my gripe about Funko, I'd like to have more participants. Like, I almost, like... It's going to be tough to podcast tomorrow unless we do, like, an afternoon podcast. of some kind, because tiredness is the thing. In fact, even right now, if this is difficult for me, I'm like being, you know, absolutely like overcome by fatigue.
Oh yeah, and it is retarded late. Yeah, like we're gonna get like no sleep.
So we should cut this right now.
Yeah, we should cut it. Well, and you know, and just
maybe I'll just pitch about. Maybe if we have a little roundtable discussion like after Comic Con, yeah, I can address.
Well, and I was thinking too that we maybe because it is gonna be a late night tomorrow night at Con. So if we're going to podcast tomorrow, we might want to do it before the end. Like when we come back to the hotel in the evening.
You know, I could even bring, all we would need is like two mics and the
Zoom. I think if we're just going to come back, maybe we should try to plan to come back for like an hour and a half and podcast.
But all right. Well, I need to go climb into bed and fall asleep right now. Okay,
so that's the end of day two.
So let's cut this. Yeah, there was a big day. I hope these things are informative. I hope we're not just like rambling about shit. I hope these things are sort of informative. If not, we apologize.
We'll try to learn our lesson. And hopefully, maybe we can be more constructive and less complainy tomorrow.
Yeah. So we'll be back tomorrow with some more shit. And then hopefully Sunday and then next week. More movie and more analysis and wrap up on this. Yeah. I'm like falling asleep right
into the mic, yeah. Well, all right, let's just cut it there then. All right, so this is Los Películas Sábados Gigantes.
Yes.
On the road from the Cinemarijuana Theatre.
Taking the Cinemarijuana Theatre on the road.
To the Chronic Con suite.
Here at Comic-Con 2015.
And we will see you tomorrow.
Yeah. Once again, I'm Ed.
And I'm John.
And yeah, we'll be back tomorrow, hopefully a little earlier and a little more under control here with another... wrap of day a wrap up of day three.
Day three, yes, Saturday, big night.
Also, just really quick, we've been drinking big time.
We weren't kidding about the fishbowl, the half gallon of the liquor.
No, and we were pounding PBRs at Spike and Mike's.
We all went with backpacks packed full of PBRs, so we are very tired. we are very buzzed. And it is time to call this a night. Okay, so good night from Comic Con 2015.
GN Comic Con.
We will see
day
you.
Day two. Those two, Condi and Dr. Malice, had the right idea.
We'll see you tomorrow.
Yeah, good night.